today. So that's why there was kind of a maze coming in here, but anyway, I want to thank her for letting us use her space, and I want to also, well, I guess we want to have some Tar Sands people say a couple words before David plays, and so I want to commend them, and I think we maybe start with Tammy, if you want to start. You want to say a few words?
Be involved, speak about it, make phone calls, write letters, do whatever you need to do to be involved. This is our planet, this is our future, this is our children's future. This is an environmental disaster, a total environmental disaster waiting to happen. Please, everybody get involved, be supportive in whatever way you personally can be supportive, and we can stop this thing. We can stop this pipeline.
Yeah!
Okay, thank you, Tammy. And Tammy's very modest, but she has gone to jail for justice to stop.
Yes.
Okay, we have someone else who's gone to jail for justice to stop the pipeline, Shannon B.
Yeah, Shannon.
Yes, thank you.
What background you come from, what age you are, this concerns every single person here on this planet. And we united can do something together. We can stop this, but we have to come together.
Yeah.
That is the key. It doesn't matter about our petty differences. We have something greater to worry about. This planet. It's the only thing we can exist on. And we're destroying it. What are you guys wanting to, like, are you willing to do something about it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Then let's do it together. It's the only way we can get it done is if we do it together.
Okay, okay, we have one more blockader here, Allie. Tar Sands development is. It's this
denial that peak oil has happened, denial that we need to transition. And if we if we just sit here and we let, you know, we let Keystone come through, we let them not pay any taxes for the spills that will inevitably happen, and we let them classify this as crude oil in their government documents and talk to, you know, the Fish and Wildlife Service and not analyze tar sands whatsoever in the possibility of spills, just analyze crude oil spills, when we know that this stuff is so incredibly toxic, is unfathomably wrong. And it's going to push us into this, you know, brown, black, terrible economy section where we let not just America, but the entire world develop on a tar sands economy and then have nothing to show for it but misery 20 or 30 years down the line. And so that's why I'm blockading, and that's why it's great to see other people. And I feel like it's great that our movement is strong, but we need to be stronger, and we need to show the world that our governments are not doing anything by going to climate conferences and lying through their teeth. That's not enough, and it will never be enough. It takes people like us to stand up and say so. So.
Just tell us a little bit about exactly what the tar sands blockade is, what the blockaders are doing.
Okay. Well, the blockaders are committed to a campaign that is nonviolent and that is in civil disobedience to the building of this pipeline. So people have been locking themselves down to machinery in order to stop work for a day or anything in protest to say that this pipeline should not be built because it really is fundamental to the it's fundamental to the expansion of the tar sands industry, the Keystone XL pipeline is. And so we're standing as a blockade to say that it is that construction should stop completely, basically. That we should not be building this Southern Gulf expansion project. We're opposed to it, we don't want it to come through, and we are not going to stop until construction stops. And that goes for this southern section, but also for the Northern Keystone XL, now that they're separate things, technically. The blockade is going to be out there, you know, garnering and standing with communities to say that that we will not accept this and tolerate.
Thanks.
Anything else you want to say?
No, I'm
okay. Do you want to give Byron the oh no, Byron, do you want to give her the
www.livestream.com.
Okay.
And it's /OWS Make Wall Street Pay Dallas.
Okay.
I'm sorry about all that, but I'll roll.
It's on my Facebook page.
Okay, well, a couple things I want to say. We do have recycling. There's a bucket out there and the trash is out there. And there's lots of food left, so please help yourself and whatever else there is. And then I want to introduce David Robicks. He has been called the peace poet and troubadour of our time. He tells it like it is, and you'll see that tonight. And how many of you have heard David's songs before?
Yeah.
Well, those of you who haven't are in for a treat, and you will really love it. Pete Seeger says, listen to David Robicks. That's a pretty big compliment right there. And Amy Goodman calls him the musical version of Democracy Now. So that'll give you a little hint. And he comes to us from Portland, Oregon. Please welcome David Robicks.
So much to Leslie, the most kick-ass organizer in Dallas.
Woo! Yeah! from sea to shining sea, we watch the Republicans TV. Newt stood with his third wife and said, "You bet your life the president is a red. He wants to tax the rich a lot, take your limo and your yacht. He wants to have the bankers' heads. And if he gets in again, he'll paint the White House pink and then he'll hire Chavez as his VP. Right on track to give capitalism the sack, along with the insurance industry. If only it were true, if only it were true. He'll subsidize windmills and maple syrup. He'll cripple industries with eco-friendly policies, and pretty soon we will be just like Europe. He'll shut down oil wells, give out solar cells to every home in Delaware and Illinois. He'll ban logging in the parks. He'll send the works of Karl Marx to the homes of every American girl and boy. He'll abolish pesticides. He'll be giving out free rides and free lunches too in his high-speed trains. He'll start lots of public works full of union perks. He'll fill all the cities up with bicycle lanes. If only it were true, if only it were true, we'd be so happy. His critics tell, "This shall be our death knell. He'll pull the troops out and end all of our wars. We'll cut military spending. Our empire will be ending, and soon we'll be invaded by the Moors. Legalize all drugs, give away beer mugs and hookahs to every child, and Korans. He'll ban religions from the schools, give 40 acres and a mule to every person who makes less than 50 grand. He'll close Guantanamo to torture. He'll say no. He'll make us all drive electric cars. He'll reinstate the fairness doctrine, take off that damn flag pin, and then he'll put Rupert Murdoch behind bars. If only it were true, if only it were true, we'd be so happy, wouldn't you? If only it were true, if only it were true, if only it were true. If only it were true, if only it were true, we'd be so happy.
St.
strangers, and they can talk as they may. But from Dublin City to San Diego, we witnessed freedom denied. So we formed the St. Patrick Battalion, and we fought on the Mexican side. What would we do? We formed the St. Patrick Battalion, and we fought on the Mexican side. We fought them in Matamoros, where their volunteers were raping the nuns. In Monterey and Cerro Gordo, we fought on as Ireland's sons. We were the red-headed fighters for freedom amidst these brown-skinned women and men. Side by side, we fought against tyranny, and I dare say we'd do it again. From Dublin City to San Diego, we witnessed freedom denied. So we formed the St. Patrick Battalion, and we fought on the Mexican side. We formed the St. Patrick Battalion, and we fought on the Mexican side.
But he was great.
Well, so I live in
probably, you know, at least what generally thinks of itself as being the hippest city in the country, and is also one of the wettest, Portland, Oregon. I moved there by accident, but there are, I think it's overrated, and I would also add that Texas is underrated, but you know, you probably would disagree living here, I don't know, but Portland has a vicious underbelly that is not well known, and so I wrote this song to try to, you know, give fair warning to anybody thinking of moving to Portland. And I don't think I mentioned rain in the song at all, because that's just passé. I've heard none of the rain. Portland is a town that's in the news much of the time. There are a lot of vegans and there's very little crime. So the folks ride bicycles a lot. The winters aren't so cold and the summers aren't so hot. They build houses out of cob. They hang out in the park where you needn't worry about walking after dark. There are lots of homeless people, but they don't hurt no one. Just be careful of the boys in blue playing with their guns. Yeah, watch out for the cops. Watch out for the cops. That's the chorus. Very complex. Watch out for the cops. Watch out for the cops. You can hang out with the punks with the piercings and tattoos. You can eat out at a food truck any neighborhood you choose. You can dance to Balkan music while you drink a microbrew. Chilling in a gay bar with the mayor and his crew. Let me hear what you say. Be prepared to take some flack, especially for those who may be male, young, and black. The fact is you do better in Sweet Home Alabama. You're safer there on the old streets of Birmingham. Yeah, watch out for the cops. 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 Yes, Portland's full of roses. There are flowers everywhere. But for others, they've got prisons with some nice electric chairs. You can go downtown, ride the buses there for free. But you never know when you'll get a DWP. A town full of progressives, but such a rotten bunch of cops. Who knows who'll get shot at the next routine traffic stop. When you live in a place like Portland where they tend to act this way, you can just join the police force instead of the KKK. Yeah, watch out for the cops. 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 You know the siren? Watch out for the cops. Watch out for the cops. Watch out for the cops. Very good. Watch out for the cops. Scanner imitation. It's
we just got UK.
Huh? Oh, somebody from the UK. So we got yeah. All right, the UK and Denmark. So I put all my songs on here so I could stop forgetting them all the time. When I was younger, I used to think it was cool to forget everything all the time. No, I just think it's stupid. You know, because it starts getting to be like where you start worrying about early senility. And you know, when you're in your 20s and you're forgetting everything, you can feel like, oh, I'm so cool because I smoke too much pot. But now, I still smoke too much pot, but I don't want to brag about it. Lots of me smoking pot on the web. If you get live streams enough, it's inevitable because they pass you joints at some shows, you know, quite regularly, in fact, in Denmark especially. Holland.
Oh,
well, you smell like burning too, and then that doesn't seem fair when I'm doing it. Exactly. Thank you.
started drilling for oil, they started building pipelines on the seabed through the forests and across the border lines. As soon as they started laying the pipe, they said, we'll do this safely. There will never be an accident. We can do this carefully. But the sand shifts, the ice melts, disasters are routine. Point at their record of destruction, and they'll say their hands are clean. Point at their woeful deeds, they consult their banker and say it's safer to use a pipeline than an oil tanker. So now they want to see how far their madness it can go. Pipeline from the tar sands to the Gulf of Mexico. Pipeline from the tar sands to the Gulf of Mexico. Tar sands lie in the north, beneath Alberta's ground. As the price of oil rises, oil men have found. Now there's profit to be made in a madman's dream. Drilling deep beneath the earth, blasting it with steam. Bulldozing the land, melting what's inside. A record of extinction, 1,000 miles wide. But laying waste to the northern plains is evidently not enough. The capitalists need markets where they can sell this toxic stuff. So across the farms and prairies, the oil now wants to flow. Pipeline from the tar sands to the Gulf of Mexico. Pipeline from the tar sands to the Gulf of Mexico. Governors oppose it, every native band. Ranchers don't want it passing through their land. Union leaders have denounced it, as have the rank and file. The president delayed it for just a little while. They say you can't stop progress. I hope that isn't true, because if we mine the tar sands, if we let the pipeline through, it will be a pipeline to oblivion, a pipeline to the end, a pipeline to a future with nothing round the bend, a pipeline to a future that I hope we'll never know. A pipeline from the tar sands to the Gulf of Mexico. A pipeline from the tar sands to the Gulf of Mexico. A pipeline from the tar sands.
It's a kind of obscure fact, but in 1993, a study was commissioned by the federal government, and they spent $1 billion on research to determine the toxicity of oil. And before 1993, no such study was ever done that was of anything close to that extent. And the reason why that study was ever done in the first place was because of what happened on August 20th through the 22nd of 1993 in Prince William Sound in Alaska. I am a fisherman, so were my parents. Here in Cordova, on Prince William Sound, I'm not a tree hugger, I love the mountains. And hauling in the gill net with the ocean all around, life was good here. You could raise a family with 100,000 tons of herring sent out every year. 1989, the tanker grounded. Nothing's ever been the same around here. Midnight sun, 100 vessels.
took to the water, pushed through a storm, and to the valley sea. We lined up our boats, formed a blockade, and we waited for whatever might be. Denmark didn't. And Denmark had lots of money and lots of technology, but they didn't build any windmills. They also have no natural resources to speak of, unlike Norway. They didn't build any nukes. They built windmills instead. But it started with one windmill. It started with a mass movement. Like usual. And it happens. It was in the 1970s. The fuel crisis. Choices were presented to us, as if we had done. The leaders of industry said they could solve the problem by mastering the power of the radioactive atom. Some folks in Western Jutland got a notion in their heads. They thought there might be something they could offer up instead. A few hundred people gathered in a little place called Tvind, and declared their will to harness the power of the wind. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. There were many who said their science wasn't sound. Such a mighty windmill would simply topple. Some of them were scientists, the vast majority were not. But they knew with years of effort, you could do a lot. Word about the project spread far and wide. 100,000 visitors came to help and to advise. Until one day these windmill builders drove in with a crane and lifted up their giant wings with a mighty chain. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. When Tvindkraft was completed, it reached up to the sky. Its wings churned in the air at 54 meters high. The critics all fell silent. No one now was jeering, as even industry agreed. This was some damn fine engineering. The wind regaled Jutland from the North Atlantic Sea as it was seamlessly converted into electricity. It was power for the people, leukemia for none, when they declared in Denmark, just south of the midnight sun. We're
We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. They gave away the patents. They said knowledge should be free. And their plans were copied by a newborn industry. Soon Denmark would be known as a windmill building nation. And it all started with some hippies at the Tvindkraft power station. Debates were held in parliament about which way things should go. Build a nuclear reactor, the majority said no. It could have gone quite differently. In much of the world it did, except for those in Ulfborg who said we're getting off the grid. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. We're gonna build the biggest windmill in the world. There was a place called the Youth House, the Ungdomshuset, the House of Youth, which was a squat that was squatted in 1982, a five-story building that was squatted in 82 by punk rockers and stuff. And the house of a right-wing religious sect called the House of the Fatherhuset, bought Ungdomshuset, the House of Youth, and destroyed it. And this is true. And it's so bizarre, it's hard to believe, but the House of the Father bought the House of Youth, and then it was destroyed. And it was a long battle that went on for months, but eventually, like, hundreds of cops came and on the roof, fumigated the place with tear gas, and then brought in foreign construction workers from Poland to destroy the place, because Danish construction workers refused to do it. And so then over the course of, like, a year and a half, people marched around every week, and the thousands, and eventually the city and the government got tired of paying for the police escort for the marches, and they bought the youth a new house that was basically comparable to the old one. And but anyway, before they destroyed the first one, when they were trying to prevent destruction, they were trying to get some media attention. And so they decided that the way to do that one day, they decided was the way was to go to this well-off area of Copenhagen where people with good jobs like to spend $40 on breakfast, which is actually not that unusual in Denmark, but this was definitely not a poor part of, there are no poor parts of Copenhagen, but this is definitely not a poor part of Copenhagen. Okay? So they're in this sort of yuppie cafe area, they're setting up. They decided they want to set up during lunch hour and have an outdoor cafe in front of the yuppie cafes in this whole big square area. But they want to do it naked to attract attention. So they build this cafe in front of all the yuppies, and it's like just a frame of the cafe with no walls. And then